to put it in the simplest terms, if we want to escape absurdity, an absurd premise, we need to walk it back by establishing a new normal every day. Get more and more and more used to recognizing that its absurdity will never be anything other than absurdity. And there's no gradualism in terms of absurdity being partially right, and yet nothing like that. It's absurd, completely absurd, 100% absurd. That's what the problem is. So in that term, there's no gradualism at all to the fact, the black and white fact, that it's absurd. But where the gradualism comes into play is establishing a new norm as far as our continuity fear. We're so used to struggling and contestment that it seems like very odd for us to, very odd for us to... Wow, a lot of traffic here. I had my opportunity there. I should have taken it. Wow. Seems very odd for us to be able to get free of it completely like that. Just boom. And yet that is what we have to do, because there's no part of absurdity that's not absurd. We can't make a deal with absurdity. Okay, looks like traffic's gonna clear out here a little bit. So gradually we see there's no gradualism. That's a nice way to put it, huh? Gradually we see there's no gradualism. Now I have to wait here again, and now I can go safely. Take a little patience there. See, there's another example of awareness of your life. Just had to be real patient until the traffic really thinned out, and then it was a piece of cake to do it. We have to patiently, gradually come to the conclusion that there's no gradualism to be found with absurdity. Absurdity has no power over awareness at all. It never will. Nothing does. It has power over reality. It's uncontested reality. So we're struggling with trying to, absurdity says, well, I'll make a deal here. And the uncontested is uncontested. There's no deal about it. Absurdity, you'll never accept that. So he says, well, let's look at it this way. No deals. There are no deals. They say, well, that's not fair. What do you mean? Is absurdity this not fair? Absurdity claiming it's got a deal is unfair. It's a lie. But that's unfair to see it that way. No, it's not. It's imminent. It's totally fair. It's the only way to see it. Seeing it any other way than that is absurdity. And they say, well, it's not fair that you're not absurd because I can't communicate with you. Well, where being a spiritual student, I mean, someone who's on the path to ultimate liberation, they have to accept their role in that, which is to hear what's being said and realize that is communication. Now the cranes are coming back here. They're whirling around here. Wow. One of them is a little higher than the other one, actually. Certainly looks that way. But maybe they're at the same height. I don't know. Maybe the distance I'm looking at is a little different, but... No, it's higher. Yeah. And it's out over the road. It's moving around. And we're going back through this gauntlet again. Oh, Lord. There's a homeless man. Young man. Wow. That's pretty amazing. Very strong young man there with a homeless sign. The first time I've ever seen that. Usually it's, you know, some Vietnam veteran, someone who's really just can't function very well anymore. That's very odd. But maybe a sign of the times. He had a real nice haircut, and wow, he could get work almost anywhere, really. Why not pay for a dwelling place in this area, right? I mean, how can you live on minimum wage here? But you have to share a house then. But you could be middle class, and we don't have any savvy about that stuff. The immigrants, they have, you know, extreme savvy here how to get into another country and make their way. They just share houses, share expenses, share everything, and help each other out like a community. Cut all the corners they can, and just so that they're not yeah, but if you're middle class like that man looked like, and you're raised in that way, wow. I mean, you're taught to stand in line, don't cut corners, don't do this, don't do that, don't do that. You've got standards of ethics and all these things you have to deal with, and it can be very tough. I tell people, hey, I gotta do stuff, and people don't take me seriously because they think, oh, you know, he's not spiritual. Someone asked me today about, you know, sickness and this and that, and I said, I don't take anything. I said, really? I said, no, I don't take medications. I said, what if, you know? But I said, you can deal with everything with your mind. And he said, well, what about like cancer? You can't deal with that with your mind. I said, sure, you can. He said, no, you can't. I said, he's like, sure, absolutely. There's no exceptions to it. He was like, really? He's like very surprised by what I said, but he didn't take offense at it. He was just like, huh? Wow. I said, yeah, lots of people. I said, these days, not so much. I look at Jesus, for instance. I mean, Christianity is founded in faith in Jesus, and he, you know, what didn't he cure? Is there something he couldn't cure? He cured his own death. I just don't think people take Christians seriously anymore in our society. They really don't. And they're for a big surprise. They're for a big surprise. If maybe some people don't call me a Christian, I don't really have to call myself anything. I call myself, you know, ecumenical Holy Spirit Christian. But it doesn't matter what you call me. But just to use the term we, but we certainly have faith in Jesus Christ and what he showed us. Absolutely. It's not some myth. It's a knowingness within us. We know who Jesus is. We know he did miracles. We know what he's capable of doing. And we know what his promises were. And so we know. We know that, so nobody's going to tell us otherwise. But there's been a massive effort to undermine faith in Jesus in this world. Massive effort. And I've done my best to prevent that, but it doesn't seem to have done any good. It's done good for me, that's for sure. But to think that Jesus can't cure cancer, or... truth can't cure cancer, and Jesus is a you know, symbol, a representation of truth, of awareness of God, and to say that Jesus, truth cannot cure cancer. I mean, it's crazy to even, this culture doesn't allow you to think straight at all. It's all crooked. It's absurd. The problem is we're dealing with an absurd premise. And absurdity says, well, in order to talk with absurdity, you have to agree with its premise. Otherwise, it doesn't understand anything you say, and it thinks you're crazy. So it's easy for those who have a right premise to speak with one another, and it's not a problem at all. But when you're trying to speak with someone who has an absurd premise, it's nothing but trouble. And therein lies the trouble that I've had. I mean, you don't need to say much to someone who has a right premise. They already know the truth. It's the ones who have the wrong premise, absurd premise, that need help, but you can't speak to them, really. So miracles are used to get attention getters, and you build up a culture around that, which Christianity did. Jesus did that. But at some point, you know, if you don't use that leverage that provides, then you're going to slide back down, which is what has happened to a lot of us. But hopefully, a lot of Christians still have faith in Jesus and recognize absurdity when they hear it. They say, you can't cure cancer. The mind, truth can't cure cancer. That's a total absurdity. Jesus cured everything, including his own death. So there's nothing that truth cannot cure easily, effortlessly. There's nothing that truth needs to do to be true. It's only absurdity that claims that, which is then a belief in time, isn't it? That's a value of time. Only absurdity values time. But I have to value time a little bit in here to keep moving on this. So, experiences here just keep giving me more information. I just talked to a grocer, said we can't. Getting papayas is extremely difficult. Been trying and trying and trying. Nothing. Finally, they got them, and the $6.99 a pound they need to put them out. And he says, hey, nobody will buy them. So he put them out at cost. Said it's just very difficult to get papayas. Distribution problem, or whatever it is, you know, from Hawaii. Interesting. Papayas represent health, actually. And can't get health anymore. We're just talking about miracles and nobody, you know, believing that the mind can cure everything easily. Sickness is just an absurdity, is all it is. So just reject an absurd premise and you won't be sick. That's all there is to it, actually. And absurdity says, no, you can't do it that easy. It's got to be difficult. And that's where we get into difficulty. Funny about that, isn't it? When absurdity claims, you know, it has to be difficult, we accept that, we get into difficulty. Hey, shouldn't be a surprise. Clouds are coming, supposed to rain soon, but after this rain, it's supposed to be clear for, I don't know, you know, 8 days or so. And warming up this weekend to like spring temperature, 75. Really very, very pleasant weather is coming here. And we don't need that. We need huge storms dumping 10 feet of snow, that kind of stuff. We don't need pleasant weather. Oh boy. Here's an issue. Here's an issue. Construction. Lane closed. Someone let me in. Thank you. We passed the good karma on, right? Pass it on. That's what you always used to say back in the 60s and 70s. Is keep the good karma moving, you know, keep it moving, right? Keep it circulating. Keep the good karma circulating. Keep doing good stuff for everybody. Keep being kind to everybody. And that's supposed to create this overall good karmic effect of people passing that on. Well, it's a nice theory. It's a nice way of looking at it, but it avoids the real work, which is to dismiss absurdity and refuse to engage with it, refuse to accept its premise, its demands, cannot accept that demand. So somebody's here, we're going to let them in. So people, we just cannot seem to get good health anymore. People are so ill and at such an early age. People used to live out in farms. There's hardly any medical attention out there. They stay healthy into a very old age. Or not. That's right. I mean, some of them wouldn't. There's quite a few. You see these old people that are over 100 now, or 100 birthday. A lot of them, you know, come from farm areas, Midwest areas. You know, that's just a less stress of a lifestyle, and you had to rely on your mind. You had to keep your mind strong. You had to. You had to see when a problem's a problem. You got to focus on it, and you got to fix it right now. And so absurdity, a lot of those people were good Christians. They read their Bible every day. They studied. They had faith. And they say, okay, I know Jesus can cure this, and so I'll just let him. He can act on my behalf on this. I trust him. That he's not doing this to make me dependent on him. That he will raise me up to full awareness of awareness. So again, the miracles are not done to make anyone dependent on the miracles. It's just a temporary expedient for those who don't have quite enough faith at this time. Someone has more faith as temporarily as a stand-in for those who have less faith, but not to make those people dependent, but to increase their faith. As Jesus would say, your faith made you whole. And they wouldn't put their faith in politicians, they put them in Jesus. And this is what politicians hate. Politicians love power. We got to understand this. They don't go, these days especially, but the politicians in general don't go into politics for any reason other than control, power, idolatry. Look at, you know, this. So the more people who look up to them and depend on them, the more they like it. They're addicted to this. And so they don't like people toting their Bibles around. And they say, what are you toting your Bibles around for? I'm here now. You put your attention on me, I'll lead you where you want to go. You don't got to keep leaning on Jesus like that. That's old style, old school. Got a new style here. Politics is where it's at. They try to foist this off on the public. And they claim those who won't go for that, they claim they're dangerous, they're nuts, they're crazy, fanatics. Dangerous, got to put them on the danger list here. They don't understand that it's the politicians that get it done here. Now, it's the politicians who don't understand at all. They're so ego-bound. They don't get Jesus at all. They don't get the good news at all. They keep saying, "What do you need the good news of Jesus?" You know, I got better news for you right here. We're gonna, you know, give you food stamps, and we're gonna give you universal health care. We're gonna take care of you. Government's gonna take care of you. You don't need Jesus to take care of you anymore. That was just a crutch that you were leaning on because you didn't know better. You're out there in the country, living on a farm, and uneducated, didn't go to university, just don't know better. But now we know better. We'll help you know better. We'll educate you so you'll know better. To lean on the politicians and the bureaucracy. It's only ignorant folk that tote their Bibles around. Yeah, that's only ignorant folk who don't tote their Bibles around. Bible in quotes, meaning any work that that is any gospel that expresses the truth of divinity, the truth of what we are, truth of awareness, the uncontestability of God, which is truth. And that outs absurdity, brings absurdity to the surface so we can see it, black and white, easy to see it. So, as we go along today, we really want miracles. We really want big time help here. And we prepare for it. When we ask for it, we shall receive it. So we thank the Holy Spirit for answering our prayer. And we're now putting ourselves in the mindset of receiving the answer to the prayer. Done some studies where they poll people in America, they say that there's a lot of people that are Christian in name only. There's Christian in name only is a high percentage of Christians. There's very low percentage of Christians that actually study the Bible, that actually really get after it. It's, I don't know what the percentage is. It's quite low percentage of Christians that do that. Was it 20% of Christians actually really committed Christians? You say we have the Easter Christmas Mass go or something like that. They only show up at Mass for Easter and Christmas, and that's it. That's a high percentage. But in Christendom in general, it's a very high percentage who are just nominal, in name only, just nominal. That's not going to get the job done. Now me, I went about in a more scientific way. I examined the evidence. And the more I examined the evidence, the more convinced I became that this is an effective way to go about it. Okay? Car needs to get off the cars. They need to. Wow, there's a car with its hazard lights flashing and it's sticking out, rear end sticking out in the freeway. I mean, there's four people inside the car. They need to get out and push the car. I mean, there's a big area there. They can just push themselves into safety there. Oh, gosh. Or pull themselves, grab the front bumper. It's a tiny little car. Probably lift the thing, carry it. But I had to go around that vehicle there. That's not good. It's like we have to go around the culture of today. They can't get out of their own way. They're blocking the freeway. The free way of health. You think that there aren't powerful vested interests in this world that don't want us to realize that that just rejecting absurdity takes care of all illness, all sickness, boom, just like that? You don't think this world is heavily invested in not realizing this? More and more and more, the economy revolves around healthcare. It's like a massive octopus. And you think this world would welcome the gospel truth that All we have to do is see absurdity as it what it really is, and not make any deals with that. And all illness, all suffering comes from absurdity, and nowhere else. And nowhere else. And nowhere else. So it's that simple. Do you really think this world and all the vested interests are interested in this truth? Speaking of interesting, I have a very interesting sky here. The clouds are coming in. It's amazing, the patterns here I'm seeing. Wow. It's like almost like a roller coaster in the sky above. Oh, man. I never see anything like that. It portends something. It's like a tile pattern of little hills and valleys. Hills and valleys, just like sine waves, sort of, as far as depth of clouds. A bunch of sine waves, clouds. The whole sky is like that way. Wow. Super unique. So what's the erosion in faith has happened? Then we're sitting ducks for healthcare. We're absolute sitting ducks. And the ego knows that, which is why it's tried so hard to undermine Jesus, along with all other teachings that they say, well, faith. No, it's not faith. It's science. That's the true science. It's the other that's faith. It's the faith that absurdity has some power that leads to all the other notions. But scientific fact that all sickness comes from absurdity, that's scientific fact. You could examine the evidence. Anyone can. If they really want to. So that call was another robocall. Congratulations. It must have been Ashley, an Ashley type, an Ashley type. Congratulations. You have been selected for a free trip, to free cruise to the Bahamas. Like, wow. It's your lucky day. Click. I don't need a free cruise to the Bahamas. I need to recognize absurdity for what it is. That's what I need. I hear about all these free trips to the Bahamas now. It's all expenses paid. You just have to agree to tell your friends about us. Interesting, isn't it? Distraction, anybody? People got their minds on a Bahama cruise. Maybe they're not paying attention to their scientific quest. It's not really faith. I mean, Christianity has the proof, the evidence, the miracles, historical record, and you can cross-reference it with other traditions. They all cross-reference one another. For instance, Anandamayi helped out with Christian faith enormously. Enormously, because she did all the miracles. She could do any miracle. And it was a non-stop parade of miracles. And just the way she was, I say, wow, if someone like this can be here, I guarantee you that someone like Jesus can be in the world. No doubt about it. So I said, hey, that really removes one of the most important scientific stumbling blocks, as it's never been done. You say, well, I mean, they keep saying, well, there's no evidence of Jesus, which is nonsense, but they can say, well, but we can say scientifically, when there's evidence, when there's one instance, that means it can happen again. As this is kind of a scientific principle. If something can be done once, then it can be done again. There must be a way to do it. We cannot just say that faith was a fluke, it's an anomaly, it can never happen again. That's not scientific. Thank you. So she gave a huge boost to our scientific conclusions about Jesus, about Christianity. Mary Baker Eddy used to call it Christian Science. Christian Science, that's right. It's a science. It's based on a lot of empirical evidence, to say, just to start with. Massive empirical evidence. The ego's always screeching about, where's your empirical evidence? And then it overlooks all the evidence that you get, you know? They talk about absurd. It insists, I only make decisions on empirical evidence, but it completely refuses to look at all the empirical evidence and make decisions based on, what? Absurdity. A lot of times the conclusion that science leads us to, we feel like, initially, like, I don't want that conclusion. But we have to be honest with ourselves, saying if the evidence leads us there, we got to make that our new normal. Have to. So then we just had a yoga girl in a wheelchair walking her dog. That's got it all, doesn't it? I mean, you can't be unfair to that, right? Absurdity, so say. You got to be fair enough to at least understand your own absurdity. Say contesting absurdity is saying that there is no contestment is contesting the belief in contestment. You can't expect a yoga girl in a wheelchair walking her dog to be able to accept that. Come on. That's absurd. It's absurd to think that we can get free of absurdity. This is what they tell us. It's absurd to think that we can get free of absurdity. So they say, you're fostering an absurdity upon us. That's what we have to deal with here. We were just discussing the problems of addiction. Very severe issues going on here. And I had a good conversation and I had some good things to say and listen to. And I go back to my old saying that the real sign of great intelligence is you find someone who's exponential higher intelligence than you do, and then make a habit of listening to them really, really well. Make a habit of listening to those who are exponentially above us in terms of intelligence. And try to, you know, reach the highest echelon you can. I mean, we can listen to E.T. and think they're exponentially above us in intelligence, but are they really? Or just a little bit? We're talking about exponentially above us. You run into Jesus, like, for instance, in such a situation. He's exponentially above us in terms of his intelligence. Right? We're different fish, apples and oranges almost, right? I mean, we don't say, well, yeah, Jesus is a little bit smarter than me. No. These are long champ, but no. I mean, this is a different fish, right? And this is the feeling we get, wow, I'm not in their league at all. These are big leaguers. I'm little league. I'm like a little leaguer. You get these people who like star in little league, and they think I'm just I'm the boss. Nobody can tell me what to do. Anyone tries to tell you what to do, everyone tries to say, I need help. Nah, you're stupid. I don't need help. And that's the addictive personality. Those people are very intelligent, and they say, to admit that I have a problem means I'm dumb. And they refuse to do so. They refuse, because to them it would just mean the loss of their meaning in life. Their meaning is based on them being intelligent. And so they say, no, I don't need help. I can just manage this. That's a sign that I'll show people how intelligent they are. Only dumb people go to rehab. This is what causes them the problem and kills them. Plain and simple. It's the syndrome is so obvious. You see so many very intelligent people get pulled down by addiction. And intelligent people have an addiction problem. I certainly have and aware of that. And I got to be very careful, because I get not to get pulled into this idea that I got to prove my intelligence through some avenue of activity or non-action or whatever. I say, no, I got to listen and hear real good those who are exponentially wiser than I am, and keep doing that. That's the only cure for me. So I've realized that. It's a daily struggle. So you reach a certain point in your intelligence where you have to actually have a daily discipline and habits on a daily basis to not fall into the trap of being smart. It's the worst trap there is. We have to pay attention every day to those who have exponentially greater wisdom than we do, who really know the truth and aren't just dilettantes. Heavyweights. Guru means heavyweight. You got to listen to the gurus, the heavyweights. We're just little leaguers here. I mean, listen to the Hall of Famers, big league Hall of Famers. And guess what? They let us listen. I had that dream when I was in a room with all the Hall of Famers, that big league Hall of Famers. That meant the heavyweight teachers, heavyweight gurus. They're all there. I said, I'm just here to recover this, like report on it and take some pictures of it. No, I'm there too for the experience of it. I had to give some excuse, you know, maybe so I had some out. Like if it gets too intense, I'm out of here. So, okay, I'm finished with my job. I took some pictures. That's it. Okay, I got to go. And no, I'm there to listen to what they have to say. Hear what they have to say. Get the flavor of it. So there's no other way other than this. And the problem is if you're really smart, you think you refuse to believe in God, because that's, by comparison, we're like, you know, morons. Of course, we don't want to admit deep down that we've been, smartness is based on absurdity. It really is. That's why I say the wise are exponentially, it's a whole different situation. It's they have a different premise. So you know it's incomparably wiser. It's not smartness. It's seeing. So we need to find those who see, who are seeing. Now I always wonder when you get some teacher who's teaching, you know, this, the non-dual, so, oh, sounds so great, you know, they really have it down. But my question is, are they seeing this right now? Are they seeing this right now? And do they see it every moment? How consistently are they actually seeing this? Or are they just being very good at parroting and reporting it? And most of the time I don't feel, I can't confidently say that I feel that they're actually seeing this. They may have had some breakthroughs, they may have glimpses of it, maybe they can get to something in meditation that's a more peaceful state, but is it really seeing? Is it, you know, true abidance? Is there some form of denying the truth that's not absurd? That's what absurdity asks us to accept. That there's some form of denying truth that is not absurd. And that's all it asks of us. It says, that's all I'm asking of you. That's not asking much, absurdity says. Is there any form of denying truth that is not absurd? Now we might feel a little bit trepidation in looking at it this way. We feel someone may not like us to look at it like this, might be upset with us. But is that form of upset with us? Is that not absurd? Is there some form of absurdity that has power over truth, that's more true than truth? Short term? Is there some form of absurdity that is not absurd? Even in the short term? Long term? Short term? Mid term? Does time really disguise? Does time really alter this question? Really a power that can alter this question. Instead of trying to answer this, we just sit in the wow. This is not a question that needs to be answered. What is self-evident doesn't need to be answered or grasped, you know, definitionally through an answer. It's just wow. So silence is a pretty good answer for this, isn't it? It's generating our wow for the day here. It's better not to respond with words at all, but because the words always imply a wiggle room, cleverness, right? There's some wiggle room there, but silence is no wiggle room. There's no answer for this. It's been seen. Now, we have to be very patient because we know how clever absurdity is in posing and trying to seem non-absurd in certain ways. It might say, yeah, I'm absurd in some ways. Yeah, okay, but it's the non-absurd part of absurdity that we want you, that you should accept. Yeah, it says like that. And that's all. What else can it do? What else can absurdity do except to be absurd? So we have to be patient and just keep seeing this and keep seeing it and keep seeing it. Hope the grace of God will delineate it even clearer for us so that we can function better, really. We can relax our mind, secure in the knowledge that we can differentiate. Absurd, he says, oh, if you see it clearly, then I'm going to get really absurd. All the parts of absurdity that aren't absurd, I'll make those absurd too. Then you'll really be in trouble. But when are we in the most trouble? Is when absurdity tries to pose as some aspects of it are not absurd. That's when so absurdity saying, I'll stop doing that. Well, of course, great. That's less troublesome. Because it really won't have a chance to do that, because we'll be able to see right through it. So say, what's the use? Yeah. So if we're going to deal with absurdity, let's do it another lifetime, not this one. No deals this lifetime. Even though we may have the yoga girls on the run, don't take anything for granted. They will throw up another format at you, another, say, yeah, but this absurdity isn't absurd. Surely you must realize that. I mean, so just, you know, so we have to, got them on the run, keep them on the run. Which is what their motto is for us, too, right? They've got the world on the run. They plan to keep it on the run. They don't want reason to make a comeback. That's absurdity is terrified of reason. But it's already made a comeback. Too late. It's already made a comeback. It's coming back right here. Just cruising through the hills here. Boy, the blossoms are going to be out. The plants are going to be growing. We have about a week or so of spring-like weather coming up. It's going to put its foot on the accelerator. We need to also accelerate and make a quick sidestepping, a burst. Didn't Jesus say something that those who believe in him will have eternal life? Well, good. There are some that won't. Don't. Absolutely do not believe. They believe in drugs. And smartness. Contestment battles and all that stuff. So they don't believe in Jesus, so it's okay. That's their choice right now. Pretty soon they may have buyer's regret and sing a different tune.